And my name is Brent. I'm the host for Canadians with Disabilities and Their Allies. And today I have Dan Trace joining me. Hi, Dan.
How the heck are you all doing today?
Good. How are you doing, Dan? Thank you very much for
Do your little spin with the phone. Can you do
I can't do that because it's plugged
that?
in, but I can.
There
Oh,
you
there we
go.
are. Oh, yeah.
It's pretty, actually pretty rainy here today, pretty gray. I'm looking out my window, facing my window right now, and it's I'm in North Toronto, so it's pretty rainy, but whatever, it is what it is.
Yeah, it's definitely overcast here. It's supposed to rain this afternoon, so far it's holding off a couple of droplets, but Mother Nature has a mind of her own, and yeah, so that's how the cookie crumbles on that area. Hey, it's better than snow, right? It's East Coast versus the West Coast, and yeah, one extreme to the next on weathers. But we've had a lot of dry spell out here. Actually, only 30 millimeters of rain in the month of March, here March, right? So yeah, it's not very good. But so Dan, so there's lots to pile in on what's happening on the city, on the city council aspect of. I hear there's going to be a by-election coming up too.
Yeah, so it's apparently mainstream media has got it in their minds that they're the official announcers, but it's been going on for like a month now. But the actual start date is April 3rd for registration, and you can sign up until May 12th. There's already, I don't know, probably my last count, about 20 people that have confirmed that they're running. And yeah, I think here in Toronto, it's at a point where we got to take on somebody that actually knows both sides of it. We all know that the economy is a necessity to make the world go round, but you also need to know the people, right? And unless you have both of those aspects in your portfolio, so to speak, you ain't gonna go nowhere. There's a lot of pairing off. What I would call that's like one candidate going against another candidate. There's about six of those going on right now. They're going to split the vote, and hopefully in the end of it on June 26th, when the election actually happens, we got somebody that's part of my French but going to give a shit about the whole community as a whole, right? Because far too long here in Toronto, just like you guys with your rental aspect of your social services there. Far too long, so many years, it's just been let go, and we got to fix it.
Yeah,
Well,
absolutely.
I know you always talk about lived experience on the show, Brent, and I don't know, Dan, you have lots of lived experience. I think most everybody that knows you knows your lived experience, but that it's so important that we have somebody in government, whether it be municipal or provincial or federal, that has that lived experience, or at least pretends to know a little bit more about it, because if you don't know anything about it, you're doing a disservice to all the people that you're supposed to be, serving.
Well, it's like I say to a lot of people, right? If your car's broken down, would you take it to a veterinarian? You know what I mean? So when we're working on, for example, one of the federal things that really bothers me, other than our PWD issues that we'll get into during this time, like one of the things that bothers me is anybody in Canada not having clean drinking water. So it's like we need the people with the lived experience, like Dan from Toronto, that has water 24/7. Isn't the expert on that speaking point, right? So we need that lived experience, whether it be homelessness, whether it be Indigenous issues, whether it be issues from the Black community, the homeless community, from women, from seniors. We need that lived experience there, right? I happened to be at an event last night. I don't know if you guys have heard out there or not. We've had a lot of violence here on the TTC lately in Toronto. And there was a 16-year-old young man murdered last Saturday by somebody that was just wandering around the TTC system with mental health issues, right? And if we send somebody in with a suit and tie just to say, oh, bad boy, the point's going to be lost, right? So we need people, like you said, with the actual lived experience in whatever issue it is to help engage the community and educate and help get to that point where we don't have to be worrying about this shit no more, right?
Well, yeah, I was watching that on our national news. There was, you know, he was like 16 years old waiting at a bus stop. It was just so tragic.
So he was actually, I don't know if he got, if it happened on the train and he wandered down, but what happened was he was sitting on a bench in front of a store at one of our subway stations.
Yeah,
and apparently it was a 22-year-old young man with some mental health issues that was actually also out on bail. And unwarranted, whatever, he just walked and did it. And it's like, what? And it touched me a little bit too, because of the simple fact that this is the area I grew up in. So this particular Kiel subway station, I frequented from like 10 years old until like 30. And it just goes to show you that, like, the station that they walked from last night, there was another incident a couple months ago where a young lady was stabbed to death on a train for no reason.
So tragic.
So they made it so that they did the walk from that station to the following station, which was the one her son was killed at. And it's slipping my mind right now. You guys can look it out if you want. But the mother, holy shit, so strong. If that were me the first day or two, like, I'd be in Kingston, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But this woman just stepped up and said, listen, my son is gone. It was because of the fact that the mental health issues that this person was facing, weren't dealt with. And I'd much rather spend the rest of my life, taking care of those issues and bringing, the word to them so that we can actually affect change. Like, this is the problem I personally have, right? Is that I don't have a problem with people protesting. I don't have a problem. I don't know. You want to throw an egg or two, whatever, do your shit, right? But if you're not going to affect change, what's the point?
Right. Exactly. Bringing to the attention of what the inequalities are, what their problems are in our society. The bail reform system needs to be changed. That the whole system has to be overhauled, because that's what they're working out in BC right now. There's people who will go out and they'll break into a store. Well, you know, during regular business hours, or people are like, oh my God, like literally 2 hours later, and the individual comes right. They take them to their precinct, and they get, you know, they book them in, and 2 hours later is back out doing the same thing, another store. And
well, and this is not to not to excuse bad behavior, because bad behavior is bad behavior. But this is exactly the type of behavior that happens when people get desperate, you know?
Yes.
And what I was going to say, a little bit of an offshoot of what we're talking about, is, I mean, we're talking a little bit about housing, you know, and the 6 years that I spent with the Sam Sullivan Disability Foundation here, you know, when I was dealing one-to-one with clients and, you know, going on coffee dates and things like that. You know, it was an employment program. So we were trying to like match people with disabilities up with employment opportunities, or at least get them job ready at the bare minimum. Right.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem that we were seeing, or at least I was seeing on the ground level, like lots of times, it wasn't so much that they couldn't, do a job or get a job, but there were so many other factors, and housing was one of them. Like, for example, and I've mentioned this before on the show, there was one guy who he was living in BC housing, so this is provincial housing stock, and one thing was, the first place that he went to, he had a guy that was threatening to kill him all, like his next door neighbor was threatening to kill him all the time. So he was going to bed at night, like scared for his life that he was literally going to wake up dead, mm-hmm. you know, from a next door neighbor that was just mentally deranged. And so then he went to, you know, he went to BC Housing, and he said, I really have to move because I have this neighbor that's threatening to kill me. And they said, well, okay, we'll move you this once. But then they said, if you put in a request to move again, we're going to just kick you off the system. Like, you know, right. it's like a one-time move. And then if that doesn't work out, too bad, you're off. Right. So right off the bat, the whole system is set up like, you know, we'll let one move go, but then if you want to move again, tough, you know. And what happened to him on the second move? I mean, it's not as bad as somebody threatening to kill you, but what was happening is, and why he wasn't able to find good work, is because he had these smelly carpets, you know, like really, really bad smelly carpets that were causing him insomnia. So like any job that he was trying to do, or any like employment thing that he was trying to engage with, do you think he could sleep? Do you think he had the concentration to be able to sleep and perform well at like a job interview or something? No, you know, like the landlord that was, you know, responsible for the suite that he was in was totally unresponsive. He didn't want to clean the carpets for the guy, because he's like, well, that's money. I don't want to put money into your place. Forget that, you know. Mm-hmm. So he's basically stuck with smelly carpets because the landlord doesn't want to do anything, and he knows that he can't go to BC Housing again, because BC Housing is going to say, well, tough, you know, bye, you know, you're out on the street. We're not going to move you again. You know, so yeah. the whole system is really messed up, where it's like, you know what, we don't care about our housing stock. We don't care if your life is being threatened. We don't care about your smelly carpets if you can't sleep. And even if you can't sleep, you're still expected to go and find work and be productive. And I mean, that's just a bunch of bull, of course. You know,
there's so many systemic problems there that need to be reformed and changed. Yeah. Modernized.
And that's what I don't get about, you know, and I'm sure we'll touch on it here, but that's what I don't get about the people that have, how do I want to word this, been outspoken this last week, the people that have made reports to the work, the people that have made integrity commissioner reports. Like, I am living in Toronto Community Housing, and I am working part-time at City Hall, advancing these issues with Toronto Community Housing. So I don't understand why this is coming from here and this is coming from here. Like, I'm one of them. I'm one of anybody listening. I'm one of you.
The experience. Yeah.
Lived experience. Exactly. Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm sure I've showed you guys that a couple times or two, but that's the actual Toronto symbol, right? It's for life. And like, would I put that tattoo on my body if I wasn't here to stand up for the rights that all of us fight for every day? So I don't understand all the infighting and shit. But I really just wish that people, and it's not me telling, it's just me advising. I really wish people would get involved in their own way and educate themselves in their own way and listen to programs like this, right? Because like you said earlier, the lived experience on the stuff, like I said, would you take your broken car to a veterinarian, right? Like, so I don't understand why it means more to get a click or a like as opposed to fixing the problems everybody's bitching about. But I mean, hey, to each his own, right? I can only control myself, and you can only control yourself. And what you guys are doing here is awesome. So I think it's a great way to get the ball rolling, right?
Yeah, and that's thank you on that, Dan. And that's a discussion that I had yesterday at our rally at our BC legislature grounds, eliminate poverty, right? I mean, it's basically bring the lived experience, all the inequalities forward, right? And a lot of the MLAs that were there and reporters asked the same question, was how can we as society work together, bring all the advocates, all the ones that are trying to work at making change happen, and little bits from every person, like every person has the great ideas, but pacing it all together and making it a better system with lived experience, rather than, and this came from one of the MLAs, was rather than, you know, he said, she said, like he said, you know, we're bad for that too, right? It's like the government's pointing fingers at each other and saying, well, we need to stop that going forward. We need to now work together and also bring people with as the disability community, not just within BC, but also across the country, working together collaboratively and on the table saying, hey, like, this is what we want to see done, change the system. Because if you give people, and this is my view, like what I said was, and it was echoed back to me, was I said, if you give people the proper money and also the resources, the tools, extra tools that they need, and income, they can succeed in society. So if you give people enough money, they can now put it back into the communities that they want, that they live in. Maybe they want to go and visit another community, or you give them the tools. Maybe they need a more adaptive equipment that they need to better their well-being, to help them mobility-wise, because that is part of who they are, is the tools. And this came from one of the reporters. You give them the tools as the, as an add-on to who they are, to help them mobility-wise, whatever it may be. So exactly what you mentioned, Dan, you know, kind of getting back to that is, how can we work together and to achieve the end result of bringing all the inequalities forward, rather than like he, you know, there's like he said, she said, and this came from an MLA. And yeah. So I totally agree. And I know who he is. I'm not going to mention his name, but.
And you think that should be a huge priority for everyone, especially the politicians, because I mean, like I said, I mean, one of the keywords is desperation. I mean, when people are desperate, they do stupid and illegal and criminal things. And again, I mean, I'm not excusing it at all. I mean, a bad behavior is a bad behavior, but I mean, the whole point, if you give people the money, maybe they're not going to be as desperate anymore, and you're going to cut down on the criminal activity and a whole host of problems, right?
Well, yeah, because well, you...
Go ahead, Brent.
Okay. I mean, you look at the underlying issue of what the problems are, and like I've said this before, when I used to have open mics and stuff on Twitter space, right, I'd get to a big debate. Like, oh my God, Brent, no. But you know, the thing is, I remember one segment that I mentioned, but I'm going to, you know, mention it now so that the viewers understand too, is, and I agree with the politicians, doesn't matter what stripe they are, right? There is a problem. There is a huge, huge problem. And nobody, like one of my neighbors, oh, you know, it'll go away. No, it won't. Like, it won't go away. Like, I just said this this morning. The problem is that there's underlying problems, right, that need to get fixed. And that is the justice system in Canada. It needs to be reformed. There needs to be tougher measures put in place. And the politicians in BC are working hard to try to change this and work and modernize this, because the bail system, they get out, they do it again. But the underlying issue is what is causing that? Like, there's so much lived experience of everyone that's homeless has their own reasons why, what's happening to them. Are they drug addicted, or did they become homeless because their building burnt down? Maybe they didn't have sprinklers in their building. They lost it, or their building was sold and condemned. They had not enough money to rent another apartment. So now they have nowhere to go. They live in a tent. And then the city say, oh, you can't be here. Shoot, get out of here. So they go to another community because they don't want to deal with it. Well, you got to work with the individuals. And that's what a lot of them, the politicians, are working. But they need to figure out is that there's individuals, unfortunately, and I'm not saying that, you know, I'm an expertise of saying, well, yeah, this is the remedy for that person. There are individuals that do need, you know, some other medical help, like to work with their situation, right? Some people say, well, we need to build a big facility, throw them in. Other ones say, well, let's work with it accordingly, right?
So well, our whole social assistance system across the country, like everywhere across Canada, all of the individual social assistance systems that are provincial, they're all founded on basically bad and negative stigma. I mean, here's that word again. I mean, it's like, and it's like, you know, we've said before, I mean, those questionnaires that you fill out is like, when's the last time you were in jail? You know, is there a warrant for your arrest and all this kind of stuff? It's like, is that really one of the first questions that should be asked of people with disabilities, is like, when's the last time you were in jail? And when, you know,
I brought that.
Is there a warrant for your arrest? And all that
I brought
kind of
that
stuff?
Topic up yesterday at the rally to one of the MLAs, and he's like, really? Yeah, it's actually on the declaration. Yeah. You know, and you got to do that every 30 days. I mean, if you have if you have you know, employment to declare, like any major changes, yes, you got to fill it out. If there's no changes to report, they don't want to hear from you. But if you have changes to report, yeah, you need to answer that question. Have you been incarcerated or imprisoned in the last 30 days? Really? Is that what how we treat our disabled?
I think the big thing is that, you know, we have to reinvent a system that's way more respectful. You know,
Oh,
it doesn't have to be perfect, but for sure be more respectful. I mean, if you have a system that says, when's the last time you were in jail, or when has it been the last warrant for your arrest? I mean, that's being completely disrespectful. So what do you expect? How do you expect people to act? I mean, it's sort of like that self-fulfilling prophecy, right? If you want people to act like criminals, set up a criminal system. Like, I mean, set up a system that's really punitive and that's really stigma laden and makes people desperate. That's exactly what the social assistance system is now all across the country. It's forcing people to be desperate because we're all living in legislative poverty. And this is what happens when people are desperate and you get that forced kind of, you know, we all think you're criminals, and we're going to treat you like criminals, even though you're just a disabled person. We don't care. You're still a criminal to us. I mean, that's the kind, it's like I said, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you think we're all criminals and we're all deserving of poverty, this is the kind of behavior that you're going to get. You're going to get that desperate behavior from people on disability, and it's not good, you know? And it starts with the government, like provincial government, changing the idea that maybe it'd be a good idea to not make people so desperate and have some sort of built-in respect and kind of reform the thing of we're not going to assume that people are all bad, you know? Let's give people a little bit of an ounce of respect.
Dignity, dignity.
So I don't
Dignity and
know
respect.
how
Yeah, what's your
how it works out there in BC with you guys. Like, if you're wishing for a hope and a prayer here in Ontario, forget about it, right? Like, it's not going to happen, right? Our social assistant system sucks. I can say, like, from being I was on OW, no joke, get this, 17 years, man. Guess how many times I saw a worker?
Two
Oh,
times.
two
Wow.
fucking times in 17
That's
years, right?
bad. Wow.
And if, for me, it is what it is. You know, I went through my life like that. I didn't really need them much at that point in time. But then when I got on to ODSP, I was on it for 2 years before I started working. And again, like, there was nothing. There was no thank you for my apartment. Thank you for my, what was it at the time? $801, not 1239 or 1258. It was $801 fucking dollars. Thank you very much for that. But where am I going? What am I doing? Right.
A
And the
cardboard
problem here in,
box.
well, exactly, right? Unless you've got an RGI unit, you're in a cardboard box in a park. And the problem here in Toronto that I'm finding, and I'm not picking on it because we've all been through a certain situation in the last couple of weeks, but there's so many different fucking, pardon my language, man. I shouldn't swear. I don't want to get you guys kicked off
We're going
YouTube
to have a swear jar
too.
for you, Dan.
Well,
A little
then I got
swear
about
jar.
50.
Oh,
And I got about
we'll
$50 here for the next half hour, right?
fill it up fast.
But it's like, for example, yesterday at council, like our council has been going on for 2 days now. And yesterday at council, everything was in a tizzy. And the TTC, which is our Toronto Transit Commission or public transit, went before city council and they said, we need your permission. We need you to move a motion to release $15 million of reserve funds, so that we can take care of just the safety issues that are going on lately. Great. Help me from not getting stabbed because I ride that shit every day, right? But the problem is you got out of 15 groups, you got about 12, 13 of the other groups going in going, yeah, it's the underlying problem. Yeah, we need to do this. And we do need to do all that, right? But this $15 million isn't for that. It's just for the immediate safety of everybody on the TTC, which includes the homeless, seniors, people like me going to work every day, people like a single mother going to Tim Hortons to make her minimum wage. By the way, boobly bits, bring it on, let's go.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So there's too many groups, that aren't focusing on the end picture. Like when I do the shit that I do and say the stuff that I say, it's because I actually want to help. It's not because I want to run for council. It's not because I want to be somebody's hero. I don't need a like or a click. I don't give a shit, right? Like whatever. It's to help people. And if you're not in it to help, like you guys are doing with this show. Like,
and here's your swear jar and it's filling up. Right here, it's filling.
There you go, buddy. First donation.
There you go.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? It's like, and we waste all this time. Like if you were to want to fall asleep today, for example, and go on to YouTube and check the Toronto City Council meeting from today, I watched it for about 4 hours before I had to have my staff meeting there. 3 hours of it was them going, I don't like you. I don't like you. I don't like what you're saying. I don't like what you're saying. Yeah. Aren't you Toronto City Council? Aren't you for the people?
Right.
Exactly. Just like there in BC, right? We all know that no government, I don't care what all these advocates say, and I don't care about the flack I get from this shit. Mm-hmm. No government is going to up and say, here's $2,000 right now on top of what you get. Here you go. So what you got to do is work through the process, and people talk about crumbs and all this shit. Take the fucking crumbs. Eat it. Because if you eat a you eat a bucket of crumbs, you're going to be full.
Well, yeah, you got to work with it. I mean, it's like you got to compromise with them. And that's the issue that, Jeff, he gets a lot of slack on it. Like he's asking, for the $2,200 a month, right? Mm-hmm. You work with it from that point on. And from that point on, you work with it and work with the government, because you ask for like $3,000-$4,000. Hey, we want $4,000. In reality, the cost of living is all up there.
And but, Jeff gets so much flack for him saying like $2,200 a month, and everybody's like, that's not enough.
It's low. Yeah.
And he has a big target on his back, just like you had a big target on your back, And it's interesting too, that it was only a couple of weeks ago that there was, maybe a bit more than that, that there was a big expose for the BC government here of, we had the BC Liberals and both the BC Liberals and the BC Greens that were kind of teaming up. See, remember they had that news conference together where side by side and saying, the legislature in BC here is super toxic. So on your last episode with you were your own guest, you were talking about toxicity and how bad it is. If everybody's got a target on their back, as soon as you try to advocate for something, you got a target on your back, and John's got a target on his back. And even the politicians, they have huge targets on their back. And we have to remember that. And, but it's all this toxicity, right? And one of the guests that's coming up, maybe we can spill the beans a little bit. We're going to have Peter Julian come on. And, he was a guest on your show way back in January.
Oh, over a year ago,
It was January 2022.
Yeah.
And he...
feels like a long time ago.
And he got attacked on your show from one of the audience members. And so that's kind of why toxicity is bad, and so we're really super glad that he's coming back on, and we've removed a lot of the vulnerabilities that Twitter Space has had, and we're creating a much more safer environment for the guests. Toxicity is a huge thing for everybody, but for advocates, for politicians, it's a huge thing.
Journalists are really getting attacked too. And you know what was ironic, Dan, is when I put out the video, when I interviewed myself as my own guest, that was actually funny. Hi, this is Brent. Introducing Brent. the same morning that when I did that, one of the journalists was actually on our local news, and they were interviewing the actual journalist who actually works at the same station. So they were interviewing her, and she was giving her lived experience of what she's gone through. And there was no way like for me to compare with what she went through. And I explained that in my video, like there was, it's no comparison, the torment that I went through. Yeah. That was real. And I look back at it and different aspects and say, and I myself, well, what could I have done better? Maybe changes going forward. there was a few minor tweaks that I could have done better in different ways. And it's all about growing pains, right? But there's nothing that I did for myself to, you know, endure harassment and death threats.
There's absolutely nothing you could have done. So as you both know, and some people that might be listening now, same bullshit happened to me, right? And although I won't, I will say, for example, I had a voicemail, and that voicemail was, you're going to do this. You must do that. If you don't, your personal life in the PWD community is going to be fucked. Do your best. Do your best. Here I am, right? I'm 45 fucking years old. I've been down that road and back, just like each and every one of you have in one way or another, right? And if you let it, it's going to bug you at the time, but if you let those people conduct the way you put forth what you want to do in your life, it's going to serve you no purpose, right? So, for example, last Saturday, just so I can express to some people, and you can go into it if you want to or not, but like when I went to that room and did what I did, and for those of you listening that might have heard it, like I was an asshole. but I was at the end of my rope, because what folks weren't told by these people that are claiming to be advocates and claiming to save the world, what they weren't told is that the London Police Service was called on me, okay, for nothing, just for the sake of somebody, as they say in the wrestling business, getting over, somebody getting clicks and likes. If that's, like I said earlier, if that's what you're into, go for it. Boom, do your thing, right?
Yeah.
Not on my watch, not on my name. And especially when I'm one of hundreds, if not thousands of people trying to help you succeed in the issues that you bring up every day, and all you're doing, fuck Trudeau, Doug Ford must go. Okay,
and the reverse is also true too, because again, going back to your situation, Brent, I mean, you were the one that was attacked, and
I had a knife on my back going, hey, you do it this way, or, and, you know,
and when you approached the phone company, they tagged that as, they said, yes, this is harassment 100%.
Yeah.
And they said, you want us to dig into it further and you want to press charges. And like, again, we said this on your show, because you're not a jerk, you just wanted to let it go. You know, so be it. But,
what I did. Right. They asked me, they approached me and asked me, and right away they knew who had been calling me. And I was like, wow, you know, and that was like that fast. And they can tell on the networks, right? And they know everything that's going on. But did you want us to dig further? And I, at the time, I mean, I had a bunch of people ask, well, why didn't you? I go, I just let it go. You know why? Because I felt the show needs to go on. Let's focus on lived experiences, focus on the guests, focus on what I need to help to bring the inequalities in the system, the systemic issues, and go forward. And that was my focus then, and it is now, and going forward. And I look at it was just trash. Like, it was just like,
well, and that's what the focus should be on, right? Like, of course, as you know, I was listening to your show the other night, and I kept my mouth shut, right?
Yeah.
But every single thing you were saying was exactly what happened to me.
Mm-hmm.
I was being harassed on the phone. I was being told that I'm no good. I was being told that people are coming for me in my job. I had, 2-3 reports put in my job, and another integrity commissioner report. And it's like I said to somebody the other day, I don't make those stupid videos that I make just to, haha, look at me, I'm at City Hall, yay.
Yeah.
No, I make it to show you people that are getting involved in this shit. You're not and I don't care, I'll call this, I'm gonna be nice, but this Deanna person going on, because she's putting herself out there, I'll put her out there, right? Great, do your thing, click. So let's stop the protesters, but not at the expense of other people. What happened the other night on that show was utterly, like, and I'm embarrassed for my own behavior too, but it was utterly disgusting in the sense that, like, I got thick skin like a rhinoceros, but you just, like, for the past couple of weeks, you guys have done damage to the people that you're saying you're helping. and you're really not helping them. And if you give $50 to one person one day, that's great. I appreciate it because I've helped and I've been helped before too. But that doesn't make you a hero.
You know, and that goes to show why that our social safety net in the country, there's so much patchwork in the system that if you just, they put it all together and give everybody enough to live and all the tools, then, you know, people are not going to be looking at saying, oh, well, you know, they wait and wait and hope that somebody's going to help them. And then we got a huge problem in our country.
There's that quote that says, hope is not a plan, right?
Right, right. And that's what
there's no plan in just hoping something will be better.
Well, and that's what I was talking to one of the officials the other day, like when the media, Sonia was talking to some other MLAs at the time, and this one media, it just came out of nowhere and said, I can ask you a few questions, right? And I said, what do you want to achieve? I said, you give people the proper resources in the country. We got all the, you know, we got, you know, EI, we got, you know, the child tax credit, we got GST, we got all these patchwork systems, CPP, we got, you know, everything, OAS. I mean, put it all together and what do you got? You got a better system, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and Joseph's going to be coming on next week and he's going to be talking about exactly a lot of that stuff. I'm sure. I'm looking forward to that. And you know, and I talked to, you know, Tom, the basic income guy in Victoria. He was there. He says, God forbid, Brett. I mean, you give somebody some money. Hey, Dan, he goes, my gosh, how that could really help a person change their life in so many ways. But no. How do we do that? I mean, my gosh, right? And it was like, we put humor into it. But in reality, it's saying, like, obviously, there's a system failure. And when I heard from a politician, and I'm not going to say the name because the person agreed that all parties, you know, they all need to do better. We all need to have lived experience. People with disabilities in the province and across Canada need to be at the table. Mm-hmm. Talk about how do they want to reform and build a better system? Because it's not working the way things are going. It's like saying, well, your government's been in power for X amount of years. Yours has been in power for so many years. Like a lot goes on behind the scenes in different provinces. And that kind of goes with Ontario. Same thing. Like, I mean, you could probably dive in a little bit more on that one, Dan, because that's, you know, your jurisdiction. But
like to eat, buddy. I want to keep the low income that I do have.
yeah, you know, and then you get people out there, they'll watch, you know, my segments, and they'll say, whoa, yeah, but you guys get more money out of your area, they put too much to your shelter, they put too much to your support. Like, really? How about just give everybody enough to make a decision that's best for them in society, right? And, you know, and it's like a he said, she said kind of thing. And it's just like,
well, the thing I don't like is when provincial governments, they just have this mentality for some reason that if you give more money to the disabled or people that are on social assistance, it's just going to be money that's going to disappear and not going to have any effect. Like, it's just going to be money that's flushed or something and nothing's going to happen with it. Well, what do you mean? Like, it's, if you put the money out there, it's going to circulate and it's going to pump. It's going to get the wheels greased, right?
And it's talking to a local business just recently. I go over there quite a bit because they got fresh produce there. And I mean, the odd time I'm going to get the odd rotten head of broccoli. But I was talking to the manager and we were talking about these segments. And the one guy, he actually tunes in, watches our episode all the time, Neil, which is awesome. Like, our show is really taking off, even at the rally. Some people said, well, yeah, I've actually watched it quite a bit. Well, you're awesome. I go, well, thanks. I mean, you know, I don't need brownie points. I just do it because I want to bring all the inequalities. I want to bring in guests that with lived experience and talk about the issues of the day. But getting back to the manager, like he had mentioned, I mean, gee, give people the money. They can now shop local. They can maybe go to maybe another province, go and visit some people. I mean, you can't be trapped within your province saying, oh, you need to have a day pass. Can I go to the washroom
Pretty please, can they go? Yeah. Hey,
please leave the province for 30 days. Yeah. Or
please, Brent, teacher. Please, teacher. Please,
I need to go to the washroom. Can I go, Brent? Just go to the washroom. Don't tell me your problems. Go. And I remember that.
I used to like the teachers that would say, when you'd say, can I go to the washroom? And they'd say, I don't know. Can you?
Yeah, I used to get that too. Oh, I mean, just go, right?
Yeah.
Well, I learned by one time I was sitting in detention. I'll never forget it. I was in grade 4. And I put up my hand, teacher, can I go to the bathroom? And ironically, I don't know if I've ever told this story before, but my grade 4 and grade 6 teacher was actually the father of PK Subban.
Oh, wow.
So Mr. Carl Subban down at Cordella Junior Public School back, oh, shit, the 80s.
Oh, wow.
But that day that I put up my hand, I'll never forget it. I probably shouldn't say this because I guess the time has lapsed enough. He threw the dictionary at me. He said, learn the word of detention.
Oh, wow.
You know, and what I got to tell people here today about everything as a whole, one thing I don't hear a lot of people say is like, housing's got to be number one. I'm hearing a lot of these advocates say, anybody that's voting for housing, don't do it. We need more money. We do need more money. Mm-hmm. But if you don't have a home to live in, what fucking good is that money, right? Yeah. Like, I didn't start succeeding myself until 2016. And that's when I got housed. That's when I was given the opportunity. Okay, here's an apartment. What are you going to do with it? I could have just sat there and drank and smoked weed and, you know, had girls over and do whatever I want, right? But I chose to parlay that into not a business, but into like helping people and at the same time furthering myself. So I firmly believe like we're too far gone in this country to just say we need more money, because we could say we need $10,000. It's a proven fact. For example, I don't know about you guys in BC, but here in Toronto, you need an annual income of about $100,000 to afford to sustain your life in a one bedroom apartment.
Yeah, it's pretty much the same thing out here.
$100,000, right? So, like, do you know anybody on ODSP or welfare that gets $100,000?
No.
So we need some kind of universal or RGI units for everybody on a certain income, right? Like, or else it's not going to work. Like, for example, if I keep working now and stay in my home here. Mm-hmm. The way it works out is the maximum I can get charged is $1,700 a month. But let's say, for example, I'm making, I don't know, I get up there past part-time and I'm making $2,200 a month. Am I going to be able to rent a one bedroom for $1,800, $1,900, $2,000?
Yeah.
Nope. And still pay my phone and eat my food and never mind my extracurricular activities I like to do.
Yeah.
Just basic food. Phone to keep in contact with, like it won't happen, right? Housing is the human right. That's the one thing I agree with on all advocates.
Yeah.
But as I said earlier, the problem is we have, and I don't give two shits who.
There's the swear jar again. Oh, he's frozen. See, he's frozen. Swore too much, and now he's frozen.
He's frozen.
There's too many groups of advocates that are. Sorry, I got interrupted there a little bit.
Yeah, you're breaking up a little bit there. Oh, maybe.
You can hear now, right?
Yeah, you're fine now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're good.
Yeah, yeah. No, sorry. There was a call coming through. I forgot to put do not disturb on my phone.
Oh, okay.
Oh, it was just, he was freezing in time. I was like, it was one of those.
You were like the Max Headroom. You remember Max Headroom? And you'd like bounce the head all over the place?
Oh, I love it. I love it. Good visual effects.
Yeah. And I actually hope, I can't see anything and I don't know what's going to happen later, right? But I actually hope people like start talking to you guys and start joining together, right? Like there's too much, I don't know what's the word you guys use, vitriol, whatever, all that bullshit going on.
Yeah.
Here's another 20.
But, you talk about, housing, Dan, and I totally 100% agree. But you know, the governments to always talk about safe drug supply, like how important it is to have safe drug supply and remove the stigma of safe drug supply. Mm-hmm. But safe housing stock is so important too, because like I said, going back to my earlier example of the one guy that had BC Housing, that's provincial housing stock, where the guy was had his life threatened. So how is that safe housing supply? We've got to have safe housing supply where people don't feel threatened, you know, and they feel safe and secure, and they're not living with a bunch of mice and a bunch of bugs and whatever, right? Or smelly carpets. I mean, the safe housing supply is just as important, well, probably way more important than safe drug supply.
Well, here's a comment that I mentioned to one of the reporters yesterday with CTV News. I'll mention it now too, because I want Dan's take.
We've got about 15 minutes before wrapping up too. So we'll
quickly mention this part here. Dan's take and then your take on it, Neil. So I mentioned to CTV News this is that we're talking about housing. So I said it's like, well, I'm glad that you mentioned it, Dan, because it was about housing is that amount. So you give people more housing and you gear their income to the rent. So
I don't know about you guys, but you're frozen here, Brent.
Oh, am I frozen? Oh. Am I frozen?
You're not frozen to me.
Oh, okay.
I think you and I are good. Oh, and Dan's gone. Well, we'll have to see if he comes back on. If he doesn't come back on, we can end the show. But we'll just, he's trying to come back on here. Okay. Well, we're almost at the end of the show anyway. So
I'll make it very brief regarding that. Mm-hmm. But it's about...
You can continue on with your closing comment then.
So, what I'll mention to, sorry for the interruption there, folks, just a little technical glitch there. So and I'll get Dan's take on this and your take on it quickly. And I know how to cram all this stuff in really quick. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what I mentioned to a reporter is right now in British Columbia, I can't really talk about other provinces because I don't really know exactly how that works, but I'm pretty sure it's probably the same thing. So right now, seniors, right, in BC, they get their supplements, right? They get their GIS, OAS, the other pensions, but the main two ones are OAS and GIS, okay? So mm-hmm. Now if they're on low income, they qualify for Safer's program. Okay. So they can live in their house or apartment, maybe condominium, townhouse, wherever it may be. Or a trailer. Maybe they live in a trailer park. I mean, they've lived there for 30, 40 years, right? I'm not moving. You can't make me move, right? Because, hey, mm-hmm. They're grandfathered in. They don't want to go nowhere because they love their home. And how I can guarantee this, like how it works, is my mom. My mom, she had old age pension and she didn't want to move. So she applied for Safers. And Safers is your rent is geared to your income. And she got to live in her same home. She didn't have to move. It's a supplement. Now it reduces down her rent. So she still paid a portion out of her money. And now she got that supplement. We got it added on. So now she pays the landlord. Bingo. So now people in BC housing, and I know in Ontario, they call it RGI. There's different names. BC housing has it here. There's different ones. That's just BC housing. There's different service providers underneath it. Okay. But mm-hmm. anyone, any PWD who is in BC housing, okay, has their rent geared to their income. Okay. So now they get that privilege of having, they lower, and I'm not saying this is saying favoritism, saying, well, you live in BC housing or anywhere in the country saying, well, you have that. Well, this is great for you. But people in market housing, you get to pay higher rent, right? That's that divide again. And I think Dan would probably maybe agree or whatever on that. He'll say, yeah, like we got to stop that. And yes, we do. Like that divide, everyone should, it should be based on their income. And I'll get your take on this too, Neil, while we wait for Dan to come on, is that that divide again, right? And I got feedback from the reporter of some of the MLAs, like we got to stop this divide of disabled of saying, well, you can have it, but you can't have it. Now, where it comes down to single mothers, single fathers, right? Mm-hmm. Bringing up children. So now they qualify if their income is low income, the RAP program. Why? Because my aunt told me about this, and that she, when she was younger, she had the rental assistance program way back when. Same thing. Now, all those programs are available, but they're not available for PWD who are in market housing. You do not qualify for that program. So what we do, we need to extend that over so that now anyone can live in market housing, right? Mm-hmm. You don't have to move. You love the place you live in or whatever community you live in. Now you have that and it follows you around.
Mm-hmm.
Bingo, mm-hmm. done, solved. I mean, yeah. Rent geared to income. I mean, how many more homeless people could actually be off the street?
Exactly right, right? Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No,
yeah, exactly. And that's the point, right? There's too many people, that are fighting for too many different things, which is granted, yeah. right? Because a lot has been left undone for the last few decades, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And again, sorry for the disruption there. I don't know what cut off there. But it's got to be something that's collaborative, right? Like no matter, like you said, whether you're in market value or regular public housing,
yeah.
It's just I'm sure it's the same across the country, right? But it just doesn't equal out, right? Like yeah, like across the corner here where I live right now, I'm paying what I'm paying in public housing. Across the corner, a two bedrooms, $3,200.
Yeah.
So how is that gonna fucking like? How is that gonna equal out? We're all in the same position, whether we're on assistance or working at the place that's gonna give us our boobly bits. But you know, we all gotta live, and housing is a basic human right. If you don't have a roof over your head, what good is $3,000 to buy you a TV and a couch if you don't got nowhere to put it?
Right.
Well. Here's something I'm gonna kind of do a follow up, like our counter on that part. I was talking to a lady who lives two doors down from here, same company that I rent from, okay? But they're managed by a different management agent. They have different agents. Our building is managed by owned and managed by the same company, but they have nine places that they have, right? Two doors down, same company, like the same name, logo, but they're managed by a complete different group. And yeah. I mean, they have rats inside their building, but anyway, whatever, they got a big problem, right? But anyway, I was talking to a lady who is a really good advocate. I bump into her every so often. I remember with our bus pass rally. So I talked to her and she gets to pay subsidized housing and in her building. I don't know how,
mm-hmm.
but she gets to live there, but her neighbors get to pay market rent. And I said, see, there's a problem there. How does that work? Like, so that, and Dan, you're right on that. Like it has to, I think it's a system across the country. They got to stop this because so many people could have so much better enhancements in their life. They can buy more healthier food. I mean, rather than paying it to corporate landlords, they could have more better their way, their life in so many ways. Okay, Neil, what's your take on this?
Well, I don't have much of a take because basically you've basically said everything that I believe too, really, that there's that real inequality of like, you deserve this in subsidized housing and sorry, you have to pay market rent. And there's that real divide, like you said.
I mentioned at the rally, Daniel, regarding, about the CPP clawback.
Mm-hmm.
I brought that topic up again, and I mentioned about like housing versus that, and I said it's unicorns.
It's
they agreed with me.
It's
they
all a bunch of unicorns. Yeah,
they agreed with me, and I said you can have this, but you can't have that.
Yeah, yeah.
And the same as housing, like it's gotta all these clawbacks have to stop. And I think we can make.
We'll support you, but as soon as your wife dies, sorry, we'll not support you anymore. That makes sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make any
sense.
I guess we'll do our ending statements. Is there any questions from the audience coming in at all?
There's no questions. I think it's just because we kind of launched very fast in a early part of the day, so there's no questions coming through at all, actually.
We'll have Dan, we'll have you come back on another day. We're gonna do this again. Our ending comments. Actually, I'll start with Dan first, and then Neil, and then I'll do my ending segment.
Well, Dan is trying to there he is. He's trying to reconnect again. I'm going to try to reposition your pin there, Dan. I've been you're up.
Yeah,
at the
just
top.
Keeps just keeps shutting off there with you guys. Like to me, your guys' screens freeze, right? I don't know what the hell it all is.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's all good though.
Yeah,
well,
it's all good.
It's, You know, the first show that we did with you, you were our guinea pig, and we had a few technical glitches, and so now we're having more technical glitches. So I guess it's just a thing. It's just a thing with you, Dan.
I'm the common denominator.
Yeah, there you go. Here's the swear jar. Here's the swear jar for you, Dan. Put more in.
I love it, Dan. Though
I'm gonna have to go back to the bank machine. I don't got enough, buddy. I got like two toonies.
There you go.
No, yeah. What it all boils down to, in a nutshell, it's like we've said all along, and we'll say it again, probably 1,000 times. Like we got. I hate that fucking term. We're all in this together. No, we're not, man. Don't kid yourself. We're not in this together.
No.
But like I've always said, focus. If I focus on housing, Brent focuses on the great transit videos he's doing. I'm following that because I'm a transit user, right? I don't drive. I haven't driven in 15 years. So if we all focus on one issue like that, like Neil focuses on disabilities and Bertie focuses on food insecurity. If we all focus on one thing and then work together on those one things, just imagine what could happen. But far too often, people are going, you, me, yay, me, truckers, honk, honk. You know, people are doing all this shit. And it's not solving anything. It's really getting us nowhere. And I just, like I said, like working together, like that's the only way it's going to happen. Somebody like me on myself, I'm a single bachelor. My kids don't live at home. I got 4 kids. None of them live at home, right? I can't even believe I'm saying this, but one's turning 28 next week.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And it's just like, how, my first question personally is, how am I still alive? I'm sure a lot of us have gone through this, right? How am I still here? What did I do to get? But then when you think about it, it's like, okay, well, I'm here. So let's share that with others, right? Like going to work at City Hall, it's not because I get the badge of honor or anything. It's because I'm giving back to the people that gave to me in my time of need. And there's too many people that can't, I don't know, the logic in their brains just doesn't go that way. And it's just all about me, right? And that's why I get upset sometimes. That's why I threw off on those people the other day. And that's why it's just going to continue to happen unless people start fucking working together, man. There's another 20.
Everyone has their own ways of actually putting back into society. But they all have to start working together. They all have to start working together. Little bits here, like you mentioned, Dan, little bits here, little bits here. That person has their idea. That person has that idea. Put it as a puzzle. Put it together. One.
And guess what? We're all entitled to our individual ideas without being attacked.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah. It's not difficult, right? And rather than saying it has to be my way or no way, and that's kind of how things went. But
And that's the same thing with those people too, right? Sorry if I'm interrupting you. Delay here. But if those people had I want to tread lightly because I really love the London police and I don't want them at my door tonight. I got a 2.5 hour head start anyway. But I can't understand for the life of me how people can sit there and say they're defending whatever, they're defending the homeless, they're defending the LGBTQ community, they're defending all these rights. If those people had have came to me and just said to me, because I had, like I said, similar conversations, if they had have just said to me, Dan, I'm not talking to you anymore because this person's helping me with this. Whatever. Let's just use an example. Basic income. If somebody had have said that to me, I would have just, okay, have a nice day. But that's not what happened, right? It went from, I'm not talking to you anymore, to this is how you're going to conduct yourself. You ain't going to tell me how to conduct myself. And then it persuaded to go into everybody piling on. And it's not just that they were piling on me. They were piling on the whole fucking community. When you said something that hit me the other day, when you said something along the lines of you're hurting the disability community, or you were bringing the disability community down, that's what you were told.
Yeah,
Brent.
Yeah.
You're breaking people's hearts.
It's breaking people's hearts. Yeah,
that's what it was. Yeah,
yeah.
Guess what? I broke those people's hearts too, because that same conversation came my way. So it's almost like it's a talking point for the group as a whole.
It's scripted. And
that's the part that I don't put up with. Like, I don't give a shit who you are. I don't, like, my mother might be watching this right now. I don't care if it was my own mother. She knows. If you say something that's not right, I'm going to listen. Like Neil said earlier, we all got differences of opinions or whatever, right? I'm going to listen to you, but I'm going to tell you straight to your face. No, you're that's fucking stupid, man. What are you talking about? Right.
Hi, Mom.
And it goes. is she watching? I don't know. I can't see anything.
No, I don't know. But if she is, I'd be like, hey.
But yeah, you know what I mean?
It's like, we got the spare jar for Dan here.
Here we go.
It's all good.
Oh, she knows better. I already owe her like $3,000. I'm good.
Oh, okay.
That's when I do that too, just so that people know, right? When I do that too, I don't know if it's a nervous thing. I don't know if it's just the way I talk and everything. It's not, I would never come to people like these people were the other day and cuss at people or direct it at people. You're going to get, you know me, you're going to get the odd F word, shit, whatever. But it's never going to be, oh, Brent, you're a fucking asshole. It's going to be, oh, hey, Brent, okay, you got a difference of opinion. I'm going to listen to you. Yeah. It might be stupid, but I'm still going to listen to you, because some things I do are like, none of us are perfect.
Exactly.
None of us are perfect. So if we helped each other, then we can get there. But like, it just seems to me, other than the core group of people that we've all talked to and other people that we all talk to in the community, like you with your MLAs and all that, and Jeff and what he does there, unless we continue to do that, it's just like, it's pointless, right? And like, I don't want to yell at myself 24/7. And I don't want to yell at this person that has no desire to fix anything. Like this young lady, not that young lady, but another one that went on the deranged, I don't even know what kind of schedule she's on, but it's like, she goes to these protests, right? And she's counter protesting the protesters that are saying no, just for example, no to the drag queen story time. Okay, but why do you got to go there if you want to do that and cuss everybody else out and tell everybody else that they're not good, they're not worthy, just because they're not on your streamline or whatever? Like, that to me is pointless. You want to go there and protest these people, go ahead, that's cool. But to dog and drag down everybody else, it's pointless. We're going to get nowhere. It's going to be this, Brent.
We're at the top of the hour, so that's a good I think that's a good ending. The little flip at the end, I think that's good. So you have closing comments, Brent.
Yes. Well, you know, Dan, I want to thank you so much for coming on today, and we're definitely gonna do this again very, very soon. And again, having people work together, little bits, pieces of the puzzle. Everyone has their own ways of putting that piece into the puzzle, right? But working together with people and saying, okay, don't always agree with everybody on the advocacy on different ways, this and that, but everyone has their ways of working together. And that's what we need to keep going as a theme across this country. Everyone working together, making it a better society for everybody, because it can be done. It can. Parties, political parties, doesn't matter what stripe it is. I mean, nonpartisan, right? A lot of stuff does get worked on, but there's also stuff that doesn't get worked on. And agreeing to, as a fundamental basic right, housing, income, doesn't matter what it is. Let's get it done. Let's, we can do this. I know we can. So I want to thank you, Dan, so much for coming on today. And
thanks, Dan.
I thank you guys for doing this shit, right? And I, like I said, I know sometimes I get out of hand, I curse and swear. We all have our moments. But like you just said, work together, right? Like we got an issue here, whether it be just in Ontario or across the whole country. I personally don't know how many premiers are liberals, right? But when, like, for example, here in Ontario, we have a PC premier. And when they're trying to work with a liberal federal government, we need everybody working together, because that just won't click, right? And exactly. And like you said, it's great to get together, great to talk, and reach out to anybody. Like my thing, I think I had to switch it to @624Dan on YouTube. So if you ever want to check out videos, But like my Twitter account at DJT624, just reach out. Again, not perfect, but anything to do with housing, homelessness, any municipal or some federal and provincial issues, I'm open. I'm an open book to anybody. So reach out anytime.
Yeah, and thank you on that, Dan. And I, you know, I want to mention one thing on my closing comments too is if you would love to be a guest for advocacy, right, or something that specific topic that you would love to come on to my show and talk about, if it's about transit, you know, and I'm big on transit, Dan, and I am glad that you follow that stuff because really, you know, transit is your basic means of transportation, right? So we need to get an intermodal across this country, right? We'll talk more on other guests who come maybe want to come on and dive into that. So if it's transit, if it's about housing, if it's about accessible housing, tiny homes, whatever it may be, is it about buildings that aren't accessible? Is it about sidewalks? Is it about bike lanes? I don't care what it is. Let's talk. Come on and just send me a direct message. And if you would rather send a message over to Neil, Neil Matheson one on Twitter, or you could send him a direct message. My DMs are open. Send me a message. Check out you know, Neil's YouTube channel. Subscribe. Check out Dan just mentioned. Check out his YouTube. Follow us all along here, everybody.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you allow me to have the closing comment, Brent, I was going to say,
yeah, go for it. Yeah.
And anybody that likes what we're doing here, likes the channel, please support it. If anybody's connected to Tim Hortons and knows how we can get a sponsorship from Tim Hortons or Roots Canada or something like that.
Or if you're a corporate company that you want to sponsor.
Yeah, corporate sponsorship. We would love that, you know, so reach out to us you know, if you love what we're doing, please support the channel, share it, and subscribe.
And we can promote your product. We can promote your service.
Yeah, we're shills. We're shills. We'll promote anything.
Yeah, and yeah, if it's boobly bits or if it's whatever it is, I mean, we'll support it.
We're just a bunch of shills.
So yeah, we'll do it. Well, thank you very much, everyone, and we'll see you again soon.